Good evening, everyone. Thanks for coming tonight. We left off in the middle of page 22. Middle of page 22, we finished these verses. Verses 1 through 5, as we're looking at Genesis chapter 3, the fall into sin. We looked a little bit last week at who is the devil, where did he come from. And just to get us started, are there any questions on what we covered or what we did not cover or something that came to your mind? Okay. All right. Let's move on then to verses 6 through 8. The next section there. When the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eye, and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some and ate it. She also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate it. And the eyes of both of them were opened, and they realized that they were naked. So they sewed fig leaves together and made coverings for themselves. And the man and his wife heard the sound of the Lord God as he was walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and they hid from the Lord God among the trees of the garden. Good evening, guys.
Hey. We brought cookies.
Mark brought cookies. Again, Mark and did Danielle make these?
No.
Hey, you're honest.
I'm not honest, man, and I appreciate it. Good evening, Danielle. Good to see you guys.
Okay, so verses 6 through 8, middle of page 22. Take a look at your notes. Eve became convinced that God was holding out on them. When she saw that the fruit of the tree was not only pleasing to the eye, but this is really the key phrase, desirable for gaining wisdom. You know, I think so often when people who do not believe the Bible and yet think they know and understand the Bible, when they think of the story of the fall into sin, the Garden of Eden, we kind of talked about this a little bit last week, right? People try to mock or laugh. Oh, you believe in that story of a talking snake and how Eve ate the forbidden apple and that was the command, right? And because Eve ate a piece of fruit, now, right, everything is destroyed. It really has very little to do with the fruit. Yes, the command was do not eat from that tree, but you begin to see the wheels turn in Eve's mind here as she contemplates desirable for gaining wisdom. What, in essence, is Eve starting to wonder about her Creator God? Is there something that He has not told us? Is there something that He has not given to us or done for us? Maybe this snake is onto something. Really, in essence, what it comes down to is really what every sin ultimately is. It's trusting or loving something more than God. That was the problem. That was the sin. Eve trusted Satan more than she trusted God. It showed itself by eating the fruit. But really, when you begin to get into her mind and you see here that she recognizes this could benefit me, this could acquire for me something that I need, something that I want, something that God has not given me. Therefore, this one here is telling the truth and God has not. That's the problem. Notice the comment about Adam. He tried to sneak away. The scripture found him. She also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate it. So you think back to the discussion we had last week about, you know, was Eve exaggerating when she explains to the devil, no, we're not supposed to eat from the tree, we're not even supposed to go near the tree. And we talked about, was this something maybe that Adam had communicated to her, or God repeated it to her? In the end, it doesn't really matter. Adam is there, and we know for a fact Adam heard it firsthand. Adam knew this was all sorts of wrong. And I oftentimes, I get into this conversation with people who want to try and say, well, you know, whether it's half-joking or there's some semblance of being serious, I think people who read this and say, well, okay, so it's Eve's fault, right, that sin is now in the world. Eve is the one who took the fruit. Eve is the one who first ate the fruit. And yet you read throughout the rest of Scripture, and never once is Eve credited with ushering sin into the world. Guess who is? The man who was with her. There was, if you remember when Adam and Eve were put into the garden, what was their number one responsibility God gave them? Take care of them. And not just in this kind of, you know, we've got to love and cherish the world, and we've got to, you know, stop the pollution and, you know, Mother Earth and all this stuff. I'm fine with that. I'm not anti-world. But first and foremost, what was Adam's number one responsibility? Not just to care for God's creation out there, but to care for the very one who was created. This is now bone from my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, for she was taken out of man. That amazing marriage vow that Adam burst into song with. And now we don't really get the impression, we're not told how much later this is. You really don't get the impression it was all that much later, right? How quickly after that moment is Adam now standing there watching his wife do the one thing their Creator God told them not to do, and he just stands there and lets her do it. And not in this sense that Adam needs to be the boss over her or smack the apple out of her hand, but you almost get this sense of carelessness. But how else do you explain it? If you're sitting there with your wife and you know that she's holding a cup of something that might contain bad things in it, not only might, but does, when you eat of it, you will surely die. Are you going to let her drink that? Maybe after a bad week. No, I'm kidding. No, the point is, Scripture attributes the entrance of sin into the world, it attributes it to Adam. That little phrase, she gave some to her husband who was with her, is not just a side note. And we'll see here in a minute, when God comes and addresses Adam and Eve, who does he go to first? Kind of guess. Innocence lost. Adam and Eve were ashamed to be naked because they no longer have perfect control over their thoughts. They were afraid when they hear God, and so they hide from Him. Isn't it interesting? We just heard at the end of chapter 2, right? Adam and Eve were in the garden, they were naked, and they felt no shame. And I said to you at the time, that's a really weird way to end the chapter of the Bible. And it is, until you get here. And you realize now how everything has changed. And isn't it interesting what Adam and Eve choose to make clothes for, to cover up? I mean, it would make sense to me if Adam and Eve, you know, took some leaves and tried to make blindfolds to cover their eyes, because it was with their eyes that Eve noticed that this fruit was pleasing to the eye and desirable for gaining wisdom. It would make sense that they would make that connection and say, our eyes are the root of the problem. Or maybe if they would have taken leaves and made earmuffs to cover up their ears because they recognized we listened to the wrong voice. We listened to the wrong person. Or it would have made sense for them to maybe make some gloves out of the leaves around them, because it was with their hands that they took the fruit and they ate it. But they don't. They now cover up what you and I don't leave the house without covering up. Because we have that same problem. We can't control our minds and our thoughts. Even with people covered up, we can't control always our minds and our thoughts. You just see how every single thing is going to change. And we're going to get into exactly how God is going to explain that. But it's just interesting that this, they notice, first thing, here's how we are different, men and women, and now we're ashamed of it. Didn't have that before. Any questions on verses 6 through 8? Okay. Let's move ahead. Verses 9 through 13. But the Lord God called to the man, where are you? Adam answered, I heard you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid. And the Lord said, who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree that I commanded you not to eat from? The man said, the woman you put here with me, she gave me some fruit from the tree, and I ate it. Then the Lord God said to the woman, what is this you have done? The woman said, the serpent deceived me, and I ate. It's such a simple cartoon, but I think it depicts it pretty perfectly, right? Take a look at your notes. Notice whom God addresses first. Compare that with, to whom does Satan address first? Adam blames Eve and God. Isn't that amazing? All in one sentence. He knocks them all down. It's not just the woman. It's the woman you put here with me. Everything was golden until she came. I was doing great. I was naming animals. I was tending all of the crops and the fruit and the trees. Life was perfect. And then she came along. Really? How long were you naming those animals, Adam, until you realized there's no one else like me? How overjoyed were you to sing that song, bone of my bones, flesh of my flesh, this is my wife. But now that he's in a jam, no one else matters. He'll throw anyone he can under the bus to save himself. And does that not perfectly describe humanity? I love everyone until I'm in trouble. Then I start looking around for who I can pass the buck off to. So Adam blames Eve and God. Eve blames the serpent. And no one takes responsibility. Take a look at the last one there. Here's kind of what I was trying to explain earlier. Eating the forbidden fruit may seem like no big deal, but keep this in mind. God had given this command, and this was the only thing he required of them so that they had a way to express their love for him. I oftentimes have people ask me, and maybe you're kind of wondering this question too, why did God even create the tree? Right? I mean, why put that temptation in front of them? And so people and even religions have then come to this illogical conclusion Well, the reason that God put the tree in the garden must have been then that he wanted them to sin. Otherwise, God would never put the tree there. No. I don't know how else you understand. Do not eat from this tree or you will die. That doesn't sound like kind of a backhanded encouragement. Think about it this way. This is the best analogy that I can come up with. Maybe you've heard another one or you can think of a better one. For those of you who have children, have raised children, remember being a child, have taken care of someone else's children, have you ever thought to yourself for a moment, you know, wouldn't it be great if there was just a little switch on your child's back that you could flip up, and while that switch was flipped up, they were perfect. Everything you asked them, they did without complaining. Everything you thought for them to do, they did before you even asked them. They just were the perfect child. Would you like that? Maybe for a while. Maybe for those really rough days, right? But eventually, what question would you begin to ask for yourself? Are they really doing these things because they love me? Or are they only doing these things because they have no other choice? Wouldn't that kind of eat away at you? I mean, I still remember as a child, it was never the thing that my mom asked me to do that meant the most to her. Doing the dishes, she could have done them, my dad could have done them, my sister could have done them. It really had little to do with the dishes. It was more about my mom knowing that this was a way for me to show her that I loved her. Very simple way, actually. That I very rarely took part in. God gives Adam and Eve a perfect will. Meaning they have a free will to be and remain perfect, without sin, in the image of God, or to not. And so here is the way God gives them the ability to exercise their perfectly free will every single day to show their love and their honor for him. Don't eat that tree. Notice what God could have said. I want you to see the ocean out there. About 2 miles out, there's a buoy. I want you to swim out to that back every single day, and then I'll know that you love me. See that mountain off in the distance? Before the sun rises, I want you guys to start hiking up it every single day. Hike to the top of the mountain and come back, and I will know that you love me. He could have made them work. He could have made them pour their blood, sweat, and tears into showing God how much they loved him, and yet all he says is, don't eat from that one tree. Oh, and by the way, everything else you see is yours. Here was their very simple way to show God, we trust you, we love you, we want to honor you with our lives, and all we have to do is avoid something that we can get everywhere else. God created that tree for a very good reason. Martin Luther, again, I reference him from time to time. I love the way that he described the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. He said, every day the tree of the knowledge of good and evil was where Adam and Eve didn't go to church. Meaning, what do you do at church, right? You go to worship God. That's a part of why we go to church. Adam and Eve avoided the tree of the knowledge of good and evil to worship God. That was their don't go there church. That's kind of a new way of looking at it. So I think there's just there's a whole lot more there than just maybe the way that you've thought about it in the past, or even, you know, had someone kind of explain it to you in the past. There's so much more here than just taking a piece of fruit, which, by the way, we don't know that it was an apple. I think that just got started because it's probably the most well-known fruit that grows from a tree, but it could have been an apple. But anyway, I think there's more to it than just them grabbing a piece of fruit and eating it. There's so much more here. So, with that being said, thoughts? Questions? Okay, let's move on then. Next page, verses 14 through 19. So the Lord God said to the serpent, oh, it's up there. Because you have done this, cursed are you above all the livestock and all the wild animals. You will crawl on your belly and you will eat dust all the days of your life. And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will crush your head and you will strike his heel. We're going to come back to this verse. To the woman, God said, I will greatly increase your pains in childbearing. With pain you will give birth to children. Your desire will be for your husband, and he will rule over you. To Adam, he said, because you listened to your wife and ate from the tree about which I commanded you, you must not eat of it. Cursed is the ground because of you. Through painful toil you will eat of it all the days of your life. It will produce thorns and thistles for you, and you will eat the plants of the field. By the sweat of your brow you will eat your food until you return to the ground, since from it you were taken. For dust you are, and to dust you will return. Those words will sound familiar to anyone who was at our Ash Wednesday service. This is where Ash Wednesday gets its name from. It is that reminder from, maybe you've even heard it at a graveside of a burial or a funeral. Ashes to ashes, dust to dust. This is where it comes from. From dust mankind was taken, was created. Out of the dust of the ground God formed man. And now God says, to that dust you will return. And that's what happens. I know this is sort of a tangent, but enough people ask me. That people have this impression in their minds that it's wrong or unchristian or sinful to be cremated when you die. Because that's not what Christians do. And my immediate response is, what do you think happens to a body in a casket, in a coffin? It turns to dust. What you're doing in cremation is you're speeding up that process. In my will, it says whatever is cheapest. You want to bury me at sea, you want to bury me in the ground, you want to cremate me, I don't really care. It does not matter. This body has served its purpose, and when the day comes, and we'll get into this in a future lesson, the Lord will raise a more glorious, sin-free body up. And regardless of where my ashes are scattered throughout the world, God will not have a problem finding them. So, tangent, but anyway, just for any of you who ever wondered that. I want to take a look at verse 15, the word that is in bold print there on the screen. It's broken down in your notes. The left-hand column is verse 15, from top to bottom. The right-hand side of that column, page 23, I think we're on, the right-hand side of that graph or that chart there is my attempt at an explanation, because this verse, I think, is kind of challenging on its own to understand. So take a look at it. God says, remember, he speaks this to whom? To the serpent, right? To Satan. He says, I will put enmity. What is enmity? Not a word we oftentimes use. It's hostility. Okay? You picture two people who do not get along. There's enmity between them. Hostility between them. God says, I'm going to place hostility between you, Satan, on the one hand, and the woman, and Eve on the other hand. This little friendship, this little budding partnership that you started with mankind, she thought you were someone who could be trusted. That's not going to continue. There's going to be hostility, enmity between you and her. And it's going to spread. And between your offspring, Satan. The hostility would also exist between Satan's followers, that is, all of his evil angels, and her offspring. That is, the descendants of Eve, or, in other words, all mankind. He will crush your head. Now, God is talking about one specific descendant. He just got done saying there's going to be enmity between your offspring, Satan, and Eve's offspring. And then he says, he. Now he's talking about one of her descendants. One of those offspring. One that is to come. We now know that as the Savior, Jesus Christ, would completely destroy Satan and his power. He will crush your head. And you will strike his heel. But in the process, Satan would inflict serious pain on the Savior. If you want to know what that pain is, come Friday night, 7 o'clock. Good Friday Tenebrae service, probably my favorite one of the year. That is where you get to see not only Satan strike Jesus' heel, but more importantly, Jesus crush Satan's head. Have any of you ever seen the movie The Passion of the Christ? Mel Gibson's movie, what came out? It's been a while, like 10 years, something like that, maybe a little less. I think it was, Mel Gibson, of course, is a Roman Catholic, so there's a couple things in there I think that he takes some liberty with, but there's one liberty that he takes that I think is very biblical. And I love this portion. If you remember, in the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus is praying, right? And it's a very dramatic moment as he's praying, and the sweat is coming down his forehead, and the Bible tells us it was like drops of blood. His disciples are a stone's throw away, and they're all sleeping. And finally, you begin to see the torches, right, being carried into the garden. And you know that's Judas and the Roman, and the Jewish leaders and the chief priests who come to arrest him. Jesus gets up from his prayer. He notices, he starts walking that way, and as he begins to walk, and you remember this, what happened? He stomps on the head of a snake. And then walks off to meet his betrayer. And I wonder, if you don't know the Bible, it seems like Jesus might hate animals. It seems like a really weird thing to do, right? Here's why. This is what Jesus is heading off to do. Like I said, we don't hear that Jesus stomped on the head of a snake as he walked out of Gethsemane. That's not the point. The point is, and I think this was awesome to point out, this is what Jesus is about to accomplish. And yes, it's not going to come without pain. It is not going to come without having his heel struck. And if you've ever had a heel bruise or a bone spur in your heel or something, you know that hurts. That can cripple you. But I'm assuming that none of you here have ever had your head crushed. Because if you had, difference. And so this is why at the top of the page, this is the Bible's first gospel promise. And it's so amazing that God would make the first gospel promise to Satan. Notice, the promise does not go well for Satan. The promise is not one for deliverance. Satan. It is one of his defeat. Is God saying to Satan, you have just destroyed my creation, but the day will come when you will be destroyed. And so here is that promise. That descendant is coming. In our next lesson, the next three lessons we're going to have are all on Jesus. And what we're going to see in our next lesson is those Old Testament references that kept pointing ahead to the one who was to come. This is the first thing that we hear about the promised Messiah. It certainly will not be the last. And as you get closer and closer to Jesus arrival in Bethlehem, the prophecies about Jesus become more clear and more concise and easier to grasp. This one, being the furthest away, I think is one of the more difficult to understand, but hopefully kind of walking through it with you makes it a little more clear. Questions? Okay. Take a look. Verses 16 through 19 list some of the consequences of sin. God here begins with Eve. Pain in childbirth. It's almost impossible, for those of you who've experienced it, it's impossible to envision it not being painful. But God says this is now a consequence. This is now a result of what has happened. Marital strife. Your desire will be for your husband. That doesn't sound like a bad thing, right? Men, that's what we want. We want our wives to desire us. But notice what is said next, and he will rule over you. What's the problem there? These two roles that God had established for Adam and Eve, the head and the helper, and how they would serve one another and serve God in doing that, is now going to be in total chaos. Eve is going to see her husband as the head of her household, and she's not going to like it. Her desire is going to be for Adam's position. She's going to want to be the head. And Adam, who was called to be the head of his family, not to rule over it, but to use his headship to serve his family, to love his family, Adam is now going to use that as his trump card to crush his wife into submission. And do you not still see that today? But why do so many marriages fall apart? Because these roles are just thrown out the window. What is your place in your home? What is your responsibility, your role within your family? When those are not established, then who does what? And then what I expect my wife to do, she doesn't want to do. And what she's expecting me to do, I don't want to do. And they don't get done, and then we hate each other for it. Eve, your desire is going to be for your husband now, but not in a loving way. In a usurping way. And the way that Adam's going to use his headship now is not going to be to serve you, to love you, to honor you, to take care of you. It's going to be to do what he just did to you in the garden at the tree. You want to take the lead, Eve? Go ahead. See what happens. Maybe God was just fibbing. He will use it to rule over you. Marital strife, now a consequence of sin. Hard, difficult labor, God says to Adam. The joy that he once had in taking care of God's creation is no longer going to be there. And ultimately death, right? For dust you are, to dust you will return. The promise that God made, when you eat of it, you will surely die. That promise stands true. Thoughts on the effects of sin here. The consequences that come with it. Okay, let's look at the last couple of verses. Then in Genesis chapter 3. Adam made his wife Eve because she would become the mother of all the living. The word Eve in Hebrew is basically a form of the verb to be, to exist. What's the point? Adam is saying nothing from now on. No human being will exist apart from this woman, the mother of all the living. The Lord God made garments of skin for Adam and his wife and clothed them. I think I mentioned this a couple weeks ago. God does the first killing in the Garden of Eden. They don't have these little tattered garments made of leaves that wouldn't have gotten them through the first hike out of the Garden of Eden, he gives them clothing that will benefit them, clothing of skin. And the Lord God said, the man has now become like one of us, God talking to himself, knowing good and evil. He must not be allowed to reach out his hand and take also from the tree of life and eat it and live forever. So the Lord God banished him from the Garden of Eden to work the ground from which he had been taken. After he drove the man out, he placed on the east side of the Garden of Eden cherubim and a flaming sword, an angel, depicted here in the picture, flashing back and forth to guard the way to the tree of life. Do you see what God is saying? Right? The tree of life is the tree you eat from and then you live forever. And God is actually helping Adam and Eve by saying, I don't want you now to eat from that tree and live in your current state forever. While death, yes, is the ultimate final result, consequence of sin, God is also now going to use that to usher you into a life that is eternal and free from sin. Okay. So God is saying, you've got to keep them away from the tree of life because we don't want them to be in this state of sin forever. Can you imagine that? Just look at an 80, 90-year-old man or woman. Imagine if there was no such thing as death. So, God doing something that seems maybe on the surface to be harsh or unfair, but in reality a very loving thing God does as he banishes Adam and Eve. Thoughts? Questions there? All right, let's take a look then into some other passages of the Bible that talk about the effects of sin. What do the following verses have to say about the effects of sin's presence in the world and among the human race? So on the left is the Bible passage. It'll be up on the screen too. On the right, then, you can fill in what effect, what consequence does sin have? Psalm 51, verse 5. King David writes, surely I was sinful at birth, sinful from the time my mother conceived me. We'll see this even more clearly in a passage here in a couple of minutes as we compare how things change from Genesis chapter 1 to Genesis chapter 4. But this is something we also see throughout the rest of Scripture. Sin is not something that I do only. The Bible says sin is also something that describes who by nature I am. I was sinful at birth, sinful even prior to coming out of my mother's womb. Because this is now the problem. Where do I ultimately get my sinful nature and tendencies from? From my parents. You pass on all of your qualities and all of your traits and all of your characteristics to your children. Did you also not think that you would pass on to them the worst of who you are? They don't just get your beautiful eye color and hair color and athletic and musical abilities. You also pass on to them the reason that you and they will both one day die. Sin. It isn't something I have to learn. It's something the Bible says I am, and I am born with. We called that original sin. Okay, original sin was the way we described that in lesson one. Matthew chapter 15. Jesus says, out of the heart come evil thoughts, murder, adultery, sexual immorality, theft, false testimony, slander. All of those things we look at and say, okay, yeah, these are sins, right? I don't know that anyone would deny those, but where do they come from? Jesus says, sin doesn't start with my hands or my mouth. Sin starts in my heart. It originates there. Again, it shows itself, right? And you think back to Eve, right? She saw that the fruit was pleasing to the eye and good for gaining wisdom and knowledge. That's already where her sin had come from. How did she show that? Well, by taking it and eating it. Jesus says here, this is where sin ultimately comes from. Why do you and I do the things that we do? Because that shows, it reveals what's inside of us. The effects of sin. Romans 5. Sin entered the world through one man. There it is, right? No Eve is mentioned. Sin entered the world through one man, and death through sin. Death entered the world through sin. And in this way, death came to all men. There's the word for all mankind, all humanity, not just men as opposed to women. Why? Because all sin. Here is the entrance, right? Sin enters the world through Adam, right? He ushers it into the world. And now through sin, what follows along with it? Death. Okay? You can't have one without the other. Where there is death, it ultimately is because of sin. Where there is sin, it will ultimately lead to death. Okay. Another one. Romans chapter 8. This might be my favorite one. Favorite, I say. It's sad as all can be. But the Apostle Paul writes, "For the creation was subjected to frustration, not by its own choice, but by the will of the one who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be liberated from its bondage to decay and brought into the glorious freedom of the children of God. We know that the whole creation has been groaning as in the pains of childbirth right up to the present time." The Apostle Paul is bringing all of creation to life here. He's picturing the mountains and the trees and the oceans with eyes, as they watch from a distance everything change. They remember what it was like to be part of a world and of creation that had no sin and no death and no disaster. They remember that. And so they long to have those days again. All of creation groans as in the pains of childbirth, deliver us. And so you think of, I preached a sermon on this, a year or so ago, and my introduction was just walking through a life or a week in the life of my house. And I talked about how the slab of cement, my front patio, has sunk down about 10 inches. I've got a crack in my ceiling. I've got siding falling off the side of my house. My car broke down. I had a sprinkler head bust and my back lawn flooded. You just go over and over and over these things and you say, why? Why all of this frustration? Why does nothing ever seem to work? Even the newest things that we get, your cell phone, your car, you know all of that stuff has a shelf life. And the day will come when it just craps out. Why does it seem like nothing in this world ever lasts? Nothing works. Everything breaks down. Everything rusts and decays and dies. Why? It all comes back to sin. There's not a fraction of your life that is not tainted by this. There is not an aspect of my life that is not affected by it. Do I have moments of joy and moments of gladness and rejoicing? Absolutely. But how long do they last? And then it's, well, what do we say? That's the way the world works. There was a time when it didn't work like that. Why does it work that way now? Sin entered the world through one man and death through sin. And it explains this bondage to decay. It explains this groaning with pain that everything in creation experiences. Humanity, animals, plants, vegetation, our world itself. I'm not saying this is an excuse to not limit, emissions in the world, that global, I'm not getting on, global warming, all that kind of stuff. What I'm saying is, even if we were the greatest human caretakers of the world, it would still decay. Now, can we stop speeding that process? Sure. But to simply look at it and say, you know, if we all just kind of, you know, pulled our pants up and got to work and started living responsibly, we could turn this world around. No. Not going to happen. It's the same reason why, if there's any hope that you or I are going to get to heaven, it's not going to be from our work. We need someone to save us. We need someone to deliver us. This world cries out with us. Someone save us. Someone deliver us from this problem that we cannot save ourselves from. Bondage to decay. Right? Does that not describe this life? And everything in it. This is the fast track. It's all on. And you and I are a part of it. Turn the page. And here's why I think probably one of the interesting things to look at. Another key point related to the effects of sin, I'm on the top of page 24 in your notes. In the last lesson, we learned that the image of God referred to holiness. How do the following verses explain that the image of God is holiness, and what has happened to the image of God as a result of the fall into sin? You remember Genesis chapter 1, right? God says, let us make man in our own image. In the image of God, he created mankind. And we talked about what that meant, right? That was holiness. That was perfection. That was a humanity without sin. Okay? Notice how things have changed. Fast forward to Genesis chapter 5. I apologize. When Adam had lived 130 years, he had a son in his own likeness, in his own image. If children were still born without sin, then they would not be born in the image of their parents. It would revert back to this, in the image of God, but there is no talk of that. This language that's used here seems strange, right? We wouldn't use that. But there's a reason for it when you remember how much things have changed. Right? Adam and Eve created the image of God. That image is now gone. And so Adam and Eve can only have children in their own image. And what is their image? It's fallen. It's bound to decay. It's now carrying that promise, from dust you were taken, and to dust you shall return. So here's our summary. Shortly after the creation of the world, some of the spirit beings or angels that God had created rebelled against his authority. As a result, God cast them out of heaven and away from his presence. But misery loves company. And so Satan, the leader of the fallen angels, tempted Adam and Eve to also disobey God, and he succeeded in bringing sin into this world. Adam and Eve, grab some cookies on your way out. Costco, top notch. I'm serious. Adam and Eve believed the devil's lie and ruined the perfect relationship they had had with the Lord. They brought sin and death into the world and rightly deserved God's eternal punishment in hell. After the fall into sin, human beings were hopelessly lost in sin. There was nothing that anyone could do to change the situation. That's why God came up with a plan. The only plan that could rescue mankind from its sinful predicament. God's plan involved one specific future descendant of Eve who would destroy the devil's power on behalf of all mankind. The rest of the Bible makes it perfectly clear that this future offspring of Eve was none other than Jesus Christ, the Son of God and the Savior of the world. In the next three lessons, we'll learn more about how Jesus saved us from our sinful condition. Not a lot of good news in this lesson, I admit that, right? It's basically an answer to the question, why is there so much pain and suffering in this world? You go back to when it started. But I hope you also take away from this that God did not leave his creation without an answer. That he did not leave them to suffer in their own sins forever. God promised a solution. He promised salvation. And notice how long it took for God to say that. He doesn't make Adam and Eve wallow around in their pity and in their pain and in their misery for decades. It's instant. God looks at Satan and says, this is how it's going to play out. You're not going to win. I'm going to destroy you and save my creation. And that's what he does. So hopefully you take that comfort also with you. Let's take a look at the agree, disagree, and then we'll be done for tonight. Number one, Satan and his angels were created by God. Again, yes and no, right? We recognize, yes, these are angels, but they're fallen angels. God created Satan, but not the way that Satan is today. Okay? Number two, Satan is a real person. You know, I don't know what a better word is to use there. I'm not trying to get you to think that, you know, there's one human being walking around in the world and that guy really is Satan incarnate. What I mean to communicate there is just, is Satan real? Yes, the Bible says. And he is the author of so much of your pain and misery in this life. He is your arch enemy. The one who finds his greatest joy in watching you suffer. Yes, he is real. Three, God told Adam and Eve not to eat from the one tree because they needed a way to show God gratitude for all his blessings. They didn't need it. They didn't need a way. God gave them this way. God wanted them to have a way to show. And isn't that something, you know, when someone does a favor for you, isn't that, you know, if you're a decent human being, and I think most of you here tonight are, isn't that almost your initial reaction? How can I pay them back? Right? What can I do to reciprocate this? How can I show my thanks for what this person did? Even if it's with a thank you or a card. You don't just stand there stone cold with no reaction on your face, with your hands out and walk away. Right? You're always looking for some way to show, and God was giving that to Adam and Eve. It wasn't like they had this need or this longing or, you know, now we got to do something to pay God back for everything he did. God was not looking for them to pay him back. They couldn't. He was giving them a way to show their love. Number four, evil has always existed. No. I think that's something that a lot of people maybe misunderstand. They kind of view, it's kind of the superhero mentality, right? Good and evil have always existed side by side and battled it out from, you know, from before the beginning of time and will forever and ever and never end. No, there was a time when there was no such thing as evil. Yeah, it seems like it was a pretty brief period, but it existed. Even before that, when only God existed, evil is not like it's always been kind of God's counterpart. There was a time when it was not. Number five, God's image was lost because of the fall into sin. Well, God didn't lose his image, but Adam and Eve did. Right? So it's not like God's image just kind of vanishes and ceases to exist after the fall into sin. But now when it comes to humanity, yes, this image of God is gone. It is lost in Adam and Eve and their descendants, including us. Number six, it was the devil's fault that Adam and Eve fell into sin. God doesn't leave the devil off the hook, right? He still curses the animal that Satan used to tempt Adam and Eve, and he also curses Satan himself. That being said, God also holds Adam and Eve accountable for their own actions. So I would say, yeah, you can say that Satan was responsible for it, but then remember a passage like Romans 5. Sin entered the world not through Satan. Sin entered the world through one man. Number seven, sickness and suffering are always the result of a specific sin that we have committed. No, we don't see that in Scripture. This is that glorified idea of karma. Now, I'm not saying that in general, this idea that if you do nice things and you help someone out, chances are you'll probably get paid back with nice things. You do bad things to someone, and yeah, I mean, it's amazing kind of how that works sometimes, that you don't always get away with it. I'm not saying that in general that doesn't work. What I'm saying is we don't have anything that we see in Scripture that pictures God with a lightning bolt in his hand. That the moment that you commit some sin, God now says, I'm going to strike you with this because you did that. Now again, are there consequences for specific sins? Sure. If I go out and drink a case of beer and drive home and crash my car and wake up in jail, I can connect the dots and say I'm in jail because I was driving under the influence. But I think sometimes, people, and I've had this conversation with I don't know how many people over the years, where, someone late in life is struck with cancer. And their thought is, I'm racking my brain to try and think of what I did that was so bad that gave me cancer. It's got nothing to do with that. Now maybe again, you smoked your whole life or you drank your whole life or whatever it was, and now this is what obviously comes. But to say that it's attached to some specific sin is not the way God works. Why does cancer exist in this world? Because sin exists in this world. Why do car accidents happen in this world? Because sometimes people don't pay attention. But ultimately, because sin exists in this world. And where there is sin, there is going to be suffering. There is going to be pain. There is going to be heartache. There will ultimately be death. You can't have one without the other. It explains everything. But I don't want you to start racking your brain to think, if I only had done this, then God wouldn't have punished me in this way. No. God doesn't work on karma's agenda. Number 8. With a great deal of effort, people could make this world perfect again. By a fall. Right? Was that Michael Jackson song, right? Heal the world. Make it a better place. Or the video, right, just inspired an entire generation, that song. I had a CD, I didn't listen to it, I was a Michael Jackson fan. But it was a pipe dream. It was never going to work. And I remind people of this too, when it comes to election time especially. If you think that by electing the right president, America is going to be saved, you're putting your faith in the wrong person. We cannot make this world what it once was. Even if every single human being in the world was this amazingly generous and faithful Christian, world would not be what it once was. Now, does that mean that we just don't give a rip and live to destroy ourselves and one another and this world in which we live? Not at all. But to think that we are the solution to our greatest problem is to underestimate our problem and to overestimate ourselves. So no. Number 9, although children learn bad habits from others, they are basically good and want to do right. I will grant this. Children are not as good at sinning as you and I are. We have more experience with it. We've had more decades of practice. That's just what happens when you practice things, you get better at them. But that being said, this explanation just... especially now as a parent, you see this. in those toddler years. Why is it that you have to work so hard to get your children to say thank you and please and give hugs and kisses and to go to bed when you ask them, but you don't have to teach them how to hit or steal or throw temper tantrums? You don't have any lessons like that for kids. Why? That's who they are by nature. That's who I am by nature. I have to work and fight and claw and scrap and scream and work until I'm blue in the face to try and make them what they're not. But you just leave a kid with absolutely no direction, with absolutely no guidelines, no rules, no help, no anything, how's it going to turn out? It's going to be tough. You need that loving environment, that guidance. And this is where the message of the Bible comes in. This is why God talks about by being brought to faith is actually a total reversal of your life. We'll talk about it later, but Paul talks about it in Romans 6, when you're baptized into Christ, your old self is drowned and done away with. Because I need that person gone. I need an entirely new life. I don't need just a couple of to-dos on a list to make myself who God wants me to be. I need to die and to become someone entirely different. And that's what God promises through His Word and through baptism. Again, we'll talk about that more. Number 10. Ever since Adam and Eve fell into sin, all people are now born neutral. That is, neither good or bad, but able to choose to be holy or unholy. Many people teach this, believe this. My question is always, then how come no one has ever picked the good? In the history of the world, why has there never been a human being, aside from Jesus Christ Himself, who never sinned? Even the greatest human beings who ever lived, if they really truly were great human beings, I think they probably would be the first to tell you, I'm far from perfect. Why didn't you choose the good path? What choice was there? Surely I was sinful from birth, sinful from the time my mother conceived me. I had failed before I ever saw the light of day. The whole point of this lesson is to show us the deep-seated sadness and reality of what sin really is. It's not just the bad stuff I say and do. It encompasses all that I am and all that I experience and everything that this creation now has become. And so it's not just that I need in Jesus this spiritual coach. I don't just need someone to encourage me to choose the right path. I need someone who is going to completely undo everything that has been done wrong. I need someone who is going to completely overhaul my life and this world in which I live. That's what Jesus does. That's why it's so important and why we hammer this point of Jesus Christ on the cross as Christians. I don't know where else you can get a more clear sign of how serious God views sin than as you watch His only begotten Son die. How do you fix that? If the wages of sin is death, so Jesus dies. Because He takes your sin and mine and suffers our fate. But this coming Sunday, we'll see how that story ended. He doesn't stay dead because He defeats death. That's the message of Easter. So, just a reminder, those services this week, starting tomorrow night, Maundy Thursday, that's the service in which we remember the institution of Holy Communion. Good Friday, we have two services, one at noon, one at 7 p.m. If you're going to come to one, I would really encourage you to come to that 7 p.m. service. and then Easter Sunday. 7 a.m., the sunrise service. If you're going to come to that, bring a blanket, bring a jacket. We're going to be outside. The weather is going to be fine, but it's going to be cold. So bring a jacket, stick around, and we'll have a different service at 8 and 10:45 with breakfast in between. We'd love to have you come and check that out. So let's close with a prayer. Gracious Lord God, thank you for allowing us to see the serious consequences that come with our sin. Lord, as we review this creation history and remember how sin entered the world through one man and death through that sin, we are convicted because we know that sin and death has been passed to us and we've done nothing to stop it. But Lord, we hold on to that promise that you once made in the garden, that promise that we've now seen and know you have carried through. The promise to send one who would destroy the devil and his works, who would undo everything that sin destroyed. Lord, what an awesome week to remember this. As we follow your path to the cross, as we follow your path to the empty tomb, and we rejoice with those first disciples, with those women who were there, with the angels who said, "Why are you looking for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen just as he said." Lord, we thank you for accomplishing our salvation, for bringing us here tonight to listen to it and to learn from it, that we might grow in the grace and knowledge of you, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. In your name we pray. Amen.